Welcome to the Abraham Factor Super Sessions, recorded live in Anaheim, California, May 6th through the 8th, 2006, featuring internationally respected marketing expert Jay Abraham. And to conclude this series, Jay Abraham now entertains final questions from the audience.
I am willing to answer a number of relevant questions. If you have a relevant question, then I'd like Albert, you guys to run to the people with the mics. If it's a wasteful question, I don't want to deal with it. But if it's a good question, I'll try to answer it right now. So if there's 10 or 15 or 20 or 30 of you, I will try to answer some questions that either are still lingering or might be useful, or you've got basically eating away at you.
I'm going from just, you know, being basically myself and to, you know, working with a whole team of people. What advice would you have for me in attracting people and keeping them on within like the budgets that, you know, I'm working with?
Well, I don't know enough about the budget you're working with, but to the extent there's a pro and a con. If you attract a colleague of mine likes to get champion racehorse super performers and pay them lavishly, but the problem is if you get too lavish of super performers, they don't stay and they take the business. And you got to figure out what you want the business to be like and what kind of people you want to represent you. And the more you need them to perform, probably the more compensation you got to give them, the more you can develop systems that perform for them. And there's a difference. I think if you need to attract people that are not going to be paid big money now because you don't have big money, you either have to have great incentives or a great environment for what I'll call brilliant waifs. Because, I mean, if you can't pay big money up front and they got to earn it out of performance, you probably are going to have to get people who are high-performing salespeople, and those aren't real stable because they're going to build it and want to go somewhere else. You're going to have to maybe have a dual compensation that thoroughly enriches them for building it and pays them very well for maintaining it, or pays them really well for building it and has them flip the client to somebody to maintain it, and they get an override and they can keep opening new markets. You just got to think about the implications. I've had situations where one of my models, which I'm not necessarily recommending, is low or no fixed salary, high performance. But that breeds people who want to make a lot of money. And if you don't give them an environment where they can do it fast, they're out of there. If they can't go the distance because you don't compensate them enough. I mean, it's interesting. Spike, you got any ideas?
Yeah, I do, Jay. One of the things, and I'll tie it back to something you started with, and that is the concept of highest and best use. You know, it's important to hire racehorses to run races and plow horses to plow the field. So, you know, specifically what you want to do is, number one, be very clear on what it is that you're trying to do in your business, the activities that go into accomplishing those goals in the business, hire the people that are best at those activities and compensate them accordingly. And if you have very defined systems, as Jay was mentioning in your former question, it's very easy to tie compensation to the performance in those specific areas, but it's critical that you have a good idea of what you're trying to accomplish, the activities that go into accomplishing that goal, and then assign people to those activities and pay them accordingly.
Okay, good. Does that help?
All right, yeah, definitely. Thank you.
You're very welcome. Yes, sir.
Jay, I've heard it said that this is probably one of the more intimate seminars you've done. I just want to thank you because you've done a wonderful job.
Oh, thank you. You've
got a lot from it. Thank you. You're a very well-dressed man as well, but that's besides
the point. My tie's too long.
If you were dropped in Nowhereville, USA, and you lost your Rolodex, and you had to rebuild your business, what strategies would you use and how would you use them?
Somebody said, if I could have any one thing I wanted, what would it be? I said, give me the rights to everything, and I'd figure out what to do with them later. But I'd probably go to a bunch of service-type low-tech service companies that had high repetitiveness and no marketing and work deals with them to reactivate their past clients or add services and get a stream of that right away, because that'd be almost a no-brainer. I would then look for ways that I could basically engineer either joint ventures with people that had that had access to markets and sort of be in the middle and get a big override. I might set up barter with big enough companies that could appreciate it. But those three things will keep you pretty well. Now, it's like we had, who said they were at that cracking the millionaire code deal? You weren't there? Oh, you weren't the one I did. Well, we had this one, and everyone there wants to make $1 million and has no idea, no money, and no time. Would you agree? So it's a little difficult, but I gave them a way to do it. And what I said was, they all want to be online marketers, and Art, you should listen to this. And I said, you know, the key is I said, you don't have to do anything. Get control of other people's of assets. Get control of their email. Get control of their traffic. Get control of their, and help them exploit it. And if you want to sell information, don't, oh, I got a point I forgot to tell you. I got to give everybody this. So just indulge me 1 minute because I'll forget this. I forgot it already. I said, if you want to sell books, you have to write a book. Go on any topic you want and go to Google or Yahoo or whatever you want to find. And don't go to the first 20 or 30 pages. Go to the last 500 pages, and there's going to be somebody there that spent their whole life building expertise and spent 30 years mastering it and 3 years writing a book and probably $25,000 or $50,000 publishing it, and it's probably sitting gathering dust in their garage, and you can get control of that. Or find people that sell books and have no back end and make a deal to get their back end. I mean, you can do anything you want, and this woman did it, Art, and she made $1 million doing it in 1 6-month period. But as I said, the irony was she did it. She was one of about 350 people. The other 349 people believed it couldn't really work, and they were right for them. So, good. I wanted to tell you a copywriting trick, a very powerful one. It's not a negative, it's a powerful one. Would you like to have access to about a $5 or $6 billion copywriting resource of the highest magnitude that you could tap into 24 hours a day for free? I call it the Amazon.com School of Business and copywriting. It's so cool. Anytime you need to write copy for anything at all, go to Amazon and put in the topic and all the related topics and find the top 25 to 50 books in each category. First thing is look at the title and the subtitle of the books and print it all out, because normally, unless the author is highly prominent, the books are going to sell on a hierarchy that is determined more by the power of the headline and the subheadline than the content. So that's copy for you. Then go to the top ones, top 25 in each category, and go to the reviews. Go to Amazon's review. If it's a big volume book, Amazon will have written a staff review. If it's not, then go to all the readers' reviews and look at the 8s to 10s, and the 3s, 2s, 1s, and 0s. Print them all out. Why? Because when people are writing reviews, either positive or negative, they are passionate. They are writing from their gut. They are expressing in the most passionate and humanized words what they like and what they don't like. These language patterns will tell you how people think. You can use what they write to write your copy. They'll tell you what they loved and what they didn't, and you can integrate those into your copy. You can write, well, you know how you want this and this and this, and how you don't want this and this and this. And they will write great ads for you, and that's like a no-brainer. That's the secret.
That's a fairly easy question. In your call letter process, when you're making calls, do you find it's good to leave a message with the voicemail, or?
Yeah, but, and this is, I'm not going to, I'm actually a little fatigued today, but if you guys remind me on one of our calls, I'll try to do an exercise. Yeah, but here's the thing. Most people are frustrated by voicemail. I love voicemail because I'm having a relationship. I use the strategy preeminence to drive the concept. I'm having a long-term relationship with that person. And if I leave the right kind of messages that promise a payout, that advance and enhance the relationship, it's only a matter of time before we're going to talk. But it's not like, this is Jay, sorry I missed you, I'll call you back. It would be anything but that. It'd be, you know, I'm sorry I didn't get a hold of you because I had a way to take your asset base and turn it into another $3 million with me doing all the work, and I'm so sorry, but the next call, maybe you'll be able to take it or have your second. And I just keep advancing it with messages that provoke them and live. Does that make sense?
Jay, my question's pretty simple. Do you have two or three behavior patterns that you've observed people leaving this these type of events have that are most successful in internalizing what's coming out of it?
I'll tell you what I believe, and probably the answer is yes, but I've never been asked to think about that, but it's a great question. I think the first thing I would do is resolve to do something when I got back. I don't care. The easiest, as I say, I try to not do the coolest or the most profitable, but the easiest to get a win or a validation on. And I would commit myself to doing things over a timeline. That's why I gave you at least a starter template. And I would hold myself accountable, and I wouldn't let myself off the hook. As I said, the tragedy to me, I have great, not regrets, but not resentment, but probably a couple of gradients below that, disappointment at people, because I give my heart and soul to them, and all I want them to do, I don't need standing ovation, I don't need a clap clap, I just need them to go out and do something with what I've instilled in them. And what I would do, and it's probably hard, I would take tomorrow off, even if you got 14 appointments. So you force yourself to put into calendared action plan, not more than you can do, but less than the maximum you can do so that you'll do it. And I would have a list, and I would only do the first thing on the list, and I wouldn't do anything until I did that, and then I'd do the second, and I'd reduce it to simplistic, but I would hold myself to a timeline, and I'd reverse engineer what had to be done, and I wouldn't pay lip service. I wouldn't cheat myself. Again, the reason I want to put you into, but I got to tell you this, and again, I've been doing this for 20 years. I put you into mastermind groups, I can promise you three things. Number one, half of you won't be on the meetings, the first one. Number two, if you choose a chairman, he or she will get too tired for it. Number three, by the third or fourth month, you won't have a group. And I mean, am I wrong, Spike? And that just crushes me. But, you know, is, I guess, I'm thinking of a word phrase, which is, that's beneath what I think you're capable of doing. Human nature is, frankly, it's not good. You have a tendency, every you, you're going to evolve to your own level, you're going to go back to status quo, you'll procrastinate, you'll equivocate, you'll contemplate. I think the key would be, if you can, call in, if you're the person to call into, call on your cell phone and say, me, I'm sick tomorrow. And then stay another day, and if you got to pay $300 to extend your airfare, so what in the scope of everything? And sit by the pool if it's warm, or sit in your room, or by the bar, or by the restaurant, and hold yourself to an understated, not an overzealous, and then do it. And if you can get groups, and you can keep them together, and you can share what you're going to do, and you tell them, hold me accountable, and if I don't, call my wife, call me. We had a guy who was very cute. I had a friend who was a very brilliant guy, a very funny guy. He had a concept he called the blackmail diet. He lost like 50,000 pounds, a lot of weight, not really that much, but a lot of weight. And you know how he did it? He was a wonderful person and very democratic. He wrote a $50,000 check from his account to the American Nazi Party, and he didn't want it cash. And the deal was, if he didn't lose this weight by a certain day, they got the money. And he basically wrote this book teaching, if you want to accomplish anything, put yourself in a position where you're really screwed if you don't do it. And I don't know what to tell you, except for there's a lot of, Spike?
Jay, and you'll know this, I won't mention the name of the client, but we have a client, or Jay has a client, that is in a very, very competitive industry, and every Wednesday is his CEO day. It's the day that he takes out of the office and he works on strategy, he works on strategic planning, he works on the things that he needs to be doing in terms of advancing his business, not the tactical stuff. When I first met Jay, I was running a company in a turnaround situation, and I was working incredible hours. I mean, it was a disastrous situation, Jay will tell you. And regardless of how many hours that I worked, I had a four-hour block every single week that I took time in my office with my door closed, the phone off the hook, and I worked on the things that were the highest leverage points in that business. So I would say that as you go back, what you should do is take out your calendar. If you do it once a week, you do it once every 2 weeks. take a two-hour block, a four-hour block, a full day, whatever it takes, to work on the things that are going to make a significant strategic difference in your business, as opposed to answering the phone, checking your emails, dealing with the hour-to-hour activities of your business.
Yeah, and a couple of other things is I try not to go in till 9 or 10. Not that I don't have a lot of work to do. Let your mind do what it was programmed to do. And also be clear on the challenges and the questions and the issues you want it to solve and work on for you. But give yourself enough time to think. I was explaining, I live 5 minutes from my office, and I'm not sure that's good. It's very convenient, and it's a very idyllic area, but when I used to have to drive an hour and a half, a lot of thinking time, a lot of reflective time. I'm not also sure that having cell phone and email is the greatest thing in the world, because it forces you, you're really not forced to be instantaneously responsive, but you think you have to. And I don't really think everybody makes the best decisions knee-jerk. And I can promise you, a lot of the things we respond to when we're annoyed or outright PO'd by email isn't in our best interest. And a lot of times people don't realize when you write things email, it is misconstrued more often than not because it doesn't have inflection. It doesn't have tonality. Something that would have been sort of cute comes off as being acerbic and biting. But I would just say, let yourself have the time. Strategy is probably the biggest leverage you've got, and if you don't give yourself time to think strategically, it's going to cost you. If you do, it's going to enrich you. And I could also say, free yourself up. If you want to, if you really, and get clear on your aspirations. I remember I said the first day, 95% of the business owners don't reach their goal because, number one, they don't have one. So the ones that have them are abstract. The ones that have them specifically don't reverse engineer them. The ones that have them specifically and reverse engineer them don't compare them to anything. I mean, do that. And it can't be instantaneous. It takes time. If you need someone to fill in for you, bite the bullet. Pay somebody salary, fee, share, variable, subcontract to get yourself free. Keep control of the activities that you know can go wrong, or at least monitor them. Don't give them too big of a leash. Keep a tether so you're comfortable, but free yourself up to do that which is really going to make you not only more money, but generate more fulfillment and more wealth. Yes?
Jay, I want to say I appreciate what you've done as far as the sequential marketing implemented in your own business, because that's exactly why I'm here. I was busy doing it in my business, answering the phone, running around in my office, and I get a cell phone call, and many of you mentioned, I think one of the gentlemen mentioned earlier, and you were on the phone. And right then and there, I realized the benefit of what you bring to the table, and this is the most comprehensive. I've been in the real estate industry, I've been to every trainer you can imagine. I paid all the big bucks to go to all the real estate trainers and learn as much as I can from my industry. But sitting here and looking at all this material, it's phenomenal. The potential revenue that you have allowed us to.
That's gracious. See. Thank you.
And I appreciate that. My question is, I'm in a small community, Lawton, Oklahoma, population of about 100,000. I command about 12% market share, and we're trying to grow the business, but we realize that our biggest potential is duplicating this business. Real estate model.
Yep.
That real is duplicating this real estate model, if you will, in another
other
market.
Places.
And by moving from an area that's 100,000 average sale price, I can raise my